Yeah, so in the collected works of the mother, since mother was also a Buddhist previously, she followed it for a long time, and she's a person who can, you know, we can really understand, use her words to understand what is Dhammapada trying to say, and because words of the mother make it very easy to understand. So what I did is I just kind of collected all the words by the mother on these verses of Dhammapada, which are, for me, I was finding it very, very relevant for all of us because it's about the mind, and all of us mostly, you know, the trouble is the mind. So it talks about the sadhana of the mind, you know, all this, these verses. So I thought why not we go kind of through these verses and maybe read words by the mother, and then we can question and discuss and reflect if there are anything, you know, any doubts or confusions. So let us start. This is mother's words herself. She says, every Friday, I shall read out to you a few verses of Dhammapada, and then we shall meditate on the text. This is to teach you mental control. If I think it is necessary, I shall give you an explanation. So many a times we see later on that mother just, somebody reads the verses, mother just says a couple of lines, and then she says, okay, let us meditate on this line. And that's it. But many a times she gives such a beautiful explanation that it makes us, it's very, very easy for us to make it implementable in our day-to-day life. So the first verse that she takes here is, and this one also is part of the verse, I'll just kind of color it, yeah. And then I'll ask one of us to request one of us rather to maybe read mother's words, and then we can take a pause and reflect over it. So this is the verse from the Dhammapada. In all things, the primordial element is mind. Mind predominates. Everything proceeds from the mind. And then this continues. If a man speaks or acts with an evil mind, suffering follows him as the wheel follows the hoof of the bullock that pulls the cart. So if I am acting out of an evil mind, it is impossible that the suffering does not follow me. Yeah? And then there are words by the mother. So anyone who feels ready to read, would be nice if you can read these lines by the mother. Yes, Nihal, you want to go?
Yeah. So I'll read the lines below the pink color mark.
Yes, yes, please.
Okay. That is to say, ordinary human life, such as it is in the present world, is ruled by the mind. Therefore, the most important thing is to control one's mind. So we shall follow a graded or conjugate discipline, to use the Dhammapada's expression, in order to develop and control our minds. There are four movements which are usually consecutive, but which in the end may be simultaneous. The first one is to observe one's thoughts. To watch over one's thoughts is the second. To control one's thoughts is the third. And to master one's thoughts is the fourth. To observe, to watch over, to control, to master. All that to get rid of an evil mind. For we are told that the man who acts or speaks with an evil mind is followed by suffering as closely as the wheel follows the hoof of a bullock that plows or draws the cart. This is our first meditation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Nehan. Yeah. So let us go over these words in our silence, and then we can share our reflections. I think it's also very relevant if we can connect this one with our own sufferings, because whenever I have suffered, it's definitely I have not been able to see my own manipulation, my own hidden agenda. You know, that's what Mother calls the evil mind, where we have all the egoistic hidden agendas, secret agendas in the mind, which are actually dictating our actions. And we, instead of looking at them and recognizing that, you know, maybe the intention is not right, what I do is I just keep on following it. And that begins a chain reaction. So if we can connect our own suffering with this paragraph, I think it would be really very, very relevant for us to notice that we are not able to catch our own manipulations. You know, maybe a want for name, a want for some fame, approval by people, you know, feeling insecurity and then running the dictate of insecurity, feeling jealous and acting according to that jealousness. So whenever we engage in certain activities like this, wanting to, you know, make yourself superior over somebody else, or maybe falling into victim identity and trying to, you know, have approval there. So whenever we engage in such actions unknowingly, it's not that we know what we are doing. And that's why becoming conscious of our own manipulations is very, very important. Otherwise, we keep on suffering. There is no end to it. I think that's where Mother shares almost, if we can say, the master key here is that there are four movements which are usually consecutive, one after the other, but in the end, maybe simultaneous, like parallel happening, to observe one's thoughts, to watch over. We can share what is the difference between, what do we think is the difference between observing one's thoughts and watching over one's thoughts, to control one's thoughts, and ultimately to master one's thoughts. So these are the four movements. And it takes a lot of time for each one of us, a lot of suffering for each one of us, before we are able to actually realize what is the manipulative agenda that I've been following, because my suffering is not ending. You know, and it takes really a long time, and we keep on suffering, and then one day when we have had enough, we kind of say that enough, now I don't want to follow the dictate of this egoistic demand. And it's not with one or other of us. I think it's with the whole humankind. There is no certain breed of people who are much purer than others. You know, we are all alike. All have tasted the egoistic consciousness. Yeah, so if any reflections are coming to you, any personal sharings on this, any questions, please.
So I think to watch over one's thought must be something like we want to really hold certain thought which needs to be controlled, and to observe must be something like we are just looking at the thought and allowing them to pass. So we are not catching hold of a particular thought which we really want to control, and or which is like you have so many thoughts going on, and out of that you recognize that yes, this is the one which is really creating all the problems, or maybe this is the one because of which the chain of actions start, and then that thought needs to be controlled. So maybe perhaps that is what is the difference between observing and watching over one's thoughts.
Yes, Nihil. Yes, anyone else wants to share on this, what Nihil has just shared? the difference or whatever your understanding of observation of thoughts, watching over thoughts, and then control and followed by a mastery of thoughts.
Yes, so I think it's a journey again, because earlier, I feel I was not able to watch my thoughts. So thoughts aa gaye aur usme beh gaye. So dheere dheere, it's like you're able to watch your thoughts, and then most of the times you're able to control your thoughts, and very rarely you are also able to master your thoughts. So I think it's a ongoing journey jo abhi jaake thoda fine tune ho raha hai, in my case I feel. And you just understand the ego's play, and ego in the sense ignorance only, na? Like you don't know it as ego. For you it's like, oh my god, were you so ignorant? Like it comes like that, as a realization. So these days, like I'm able to, like things that trouble me also, the thoughts, as soon as they start, I'm so vigilant that I'm able to watch it and then again bring back the focus to my inner world, or connect to myself, or connect to the body, or go through a simple for a few moments, just distract myself from those thoughts, and it is definitely helping. So yeah, I can relate to this process that mother is sharing here for us. So yeah.
Yeah, thank you, Shweta. Sambhav, you want to share?
So watching over the thoughts and observing the thoughts, I cannot differentiate between the two, but at the same time I have a very beautiful imagery which can help us understand what observing the thoughts is. So, for example, if you like in a 26th January parade in a Republic Day, so we there's a whole jaise kehte hain jhaakiyan jaati hain road pe, and the president of the country is just sitting and watching the parade going on, but he does not just get off his chair and starts dancing with the troops or dancing with the parade. So just like that, we have to sit in the president's seat, and we have to observe the parade going of thoughts going on in front of us, but we do not jump from our seat and get involved in the whole drama. So that is, I guess, observing the thoughts is. But I'm not sure what watching the thoughts is does mean. I mean, I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's a very helpful imagery that you shared. So whenever we are able to observe, a stepping back happens automatically. As Sambhav was sharing that the president is watching, he's not jumping or dancing along with the troops. Usually, I think Shweta was sharing earlier that usually we are swayed by the thoughts. We don't even realize that I have become the thought. It takes a lot of effort, and also we need to have suffered enough so that now I am ready to observe. Because I've been puppeted by the thoughts enough, and now I want to observe. Okay, so it needs a little stepping back. Like you have created a bit of a space. Earlier the movement was this, like this along with the thoughts, me and my story. Now the movement has become a bit kind of dissociated, that there is a kind of a witnessing presence watching the coming and going, as you were sharing, all of you, the coming and going of thoughts. But I believe that to watch over is something which requires a bit of discernment. That I'm able to see the quality of thoughts. I'm able to see the nature of thoughts. Which one is the negative? Which one is the trappy thought? Which one is a harmless thought? Like, buying bread and butter, harmless. Go buy bread and butter. Calculating logic analysis that, okay, this much money required for this action. Harmless, comes and goes. But then there are also thoughts which are very trappy and sticky in nature, and they are very different for each one of us, although the crux for them is me and my story. That's where we all are trapped, right? So watching over one thoughts, I believe, requires a bit of discrimination from our side, that I am able to now see the quality of each thought. Okay, which one is red, which although they are hollow only, ultimately वहां पे कुछ मिलने नहीं वाला, but now I am able to see the quality of them. Control is a further step beyond that. Now I am able to see which one to permit, which one not to permit. As I think Shweta was hinting at, that now I am able to see that this is permissible. I can, you know, indulge in this one, maybe calculating about a plan that you have to make. But indulging in the past and future stories, just out of a mind, you know, game, maybe not required. So you don't permit them. That requires a little bit of control. Much beyond than control becomes mastery, self-mastery. You know, that whenever we talk that he is a master musician, we know that this guy is a little towards perfection. Now, perfection is something which we can never touch, but we can always walk towards perfection. Because even masters would say, abhi to mujhe bahut seekhna hai. You know, all the masters would say that, abhi to mujhe bahut seekhna hai, abhi to mujhe bahut seekhna hai. So there is no limit to mastery, but there is a level of expertise there, that there is an inner sanctity that is maintained. And it's not that every thought and feeling would come and go and play havoc and tsunami in my area, and I am just kind of puppeted around. So I think in these four lines, Mother or also Dhammapada, you know, it covers the whole, almost essence of life, the sadhana of life. You know, this much, it's so easier said than done. Think about it. Sit with your breath for a couple of moments. See how long you can sit. A thought comes, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe fifth breath. A thought comes, oh, what will I cook for dinner? And we just go and, you know, kind of, and then again, you will realize, oh my God, where is the breath? And then we come back to the breath. So breath is a beautiful way to silence the noisy default pattern and chatter of mind. Otherwise, we keep on giving importance to any random thought that comes, any random thoughts. No, so here, all of us suffer through that. No one can be happy remaining in their thoughts. You know, even in the yesterday's session also, you know, somebody was sharing that overthinking is my problem. And I shared with her that not only your problem, all of us suffer from overthinking. You know, as if we have no control, no mastery at all. So if we are to purify our inner temple, those of us who want to, it's extremely necessary to walk this path of purifying our mind, silencing the mind, decluttering almost, you know, decluttering, making space in the mind, making it airy. And then Mother says that, why are we doing this? Why are we observing? Why are we watching? Why are we controlling the mind? Because if a man speaks or acts with an evil mind, suffering will follow as the wheel follows the hoof of the bullock that pulls the cart. So bullock, you know, the you know, bullock is tied to the cart, tied. So there is no point that the cart will not follow the bullock. If I am acting through an evil mind because I'm not purifying my mind, it is impossible that suffering does not follow me. And since the whole of mankind suffers in one way or the other, we all have evil minds. Bura jo dekhan main chala, bura na milia koi. Jo man khoja apna, mujhse bura na koi. So can we recognize this as a fact that yes, this is where I am right now, but this is not my destiny. I don't have to be here. I can purify. So this is where we begin, noticing what is right here and wanting, having a willingness for a cleaner inner, you know, kind of temple. And then these are conjugate verses. So along with this, there is another verse which says the vice versa of this. What is this? It says, mind predominates. Everything proceeds from mind. If a man speaks or acts with a purified mind, happiness accompanies him as closely as his inseparable shadow. Beautiful, you know, that if suffering, so we can also use it vice versa. If suffering is there in my life, I have to purify myself. Simple. And if I am okay, if I am peaceful, for even for a moment, in that moment, purity is there, I can be sure. Not that we want to know, because when we are happy and peaceful, we don't want to know really, you know, that what really did I do and what all. But it's like a byproduct. Happiness and peace is a byproduct. Because evil mind is like a dark cloud which obscures the purified mind, the blue sky. You know, so when the evil mind is purified, when the dark cloud is seen or, you know, it disperses, all that is left is the blue sky, and which is peace and happiness shining. So let us go through these words by the mother. Anyone who feels ready to read, would be nice if you can read it.
May I?
Yes, 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 Sambhu.
So I should read from, this is the counterpart, right? Okay, mind. Okay.
You can also read the verse and then follow the word by the mother.
Mind predominates. Everything proceeds from mind. If a man speaks or acts with a purified mind, happiness accompanies him as closely as his inseparable shadow. This is the counterpart of what we read last time. The Dhammapada contrasts a purified mind with an evil mind. We have already said that there are four successive stages for the purification of the mind. A purified mind is naturally a mind that does not admit any wrong thought. And we have seen that the complete mastery of thought which is required to gain this result is the last achievement in the four stages I have spoken of. The first is to observe one's mind. Do not believe that it is such an easy thing. For to observe your thoughts, you must first of all separate yourself from them. In the ordinary state, the ordinary man does not distinguish himself from his thoughts. He does not even know what he thinks. He thinks by habit. And if he is asked all of a sudden, what are you thinking of? He knows nothing about it. That is to say, 95 times of 100, he will answer, I do not know. There's a complete identification between the movement of thought and the consciousness of the being. To observe the thought, the first movement then is to step back and look at it, to separate yourself from your thoughts so that the movement of the consciousness and that of thought may not be confused. Thus, when we say that one must observe one's thoughts, do not believe that it is so simple. It is the first step. I suggest that this evening in our meditation, we take up this first exercise, which consists in standing back from one's thought and looking at it.
Yeah, thank you, Sambhu. So mother suggests an exercise, which she has suggested at other place. And she says that look back at your whole life, and see what you call as myself. Is the body myself? Because that is changing, you know. Earlier it was a little body, now it has grown up, and even now it keeps on changing. Then she says, is thoughts myself? Again, thoughts come, go, keep on changing, right? Or every time new stories are being created in the mind. So there also I cannot say that there is a continuity, you know, which is an unchanging continuity. So thoughts also I cannot call as myself. I can see them coming and going. Body also I can see changing. Feelings, emotions come and go, come and go. And she says there is one thing which does not come and go. If you look back at your life, which has never gone anywhere, which has ever stayed with you. And that is this presence of consciousness in you, which is able to look at all the movements of your life. When I was little, when I was in college, you know, when I was maybe dreaming. So this consciousness is a common continuing thread which has never changed. This looking, other words for this is presence of this awareness, presence of consciousness, or we can say the knowing with which I know a thought, the knowing with which I know a feeling, the knowing with which I know a bodily ache or pain or sense perception, the knowing with which I become aware of my depression. That knowing forever stays the same. And this knowing is present in each one of us. It's the one being that we share. So my knowing is same as your knowing. It knows a thought. My knowing knows my thought. Your knowing knows your thought. So the quality of the knowing is same. And also there is a continuity. It never changes. It's neutral. Knowing does not say, no, this is a bad thought. I don't want to know it. Right? Even there are bad thoughts. We know that there are bad thoughts. So there is the knowing is still there. Knowing does not say, no, this is a disease. I don't want to. So there is no preference when we station ourselves as this knowing. So this is one meditation which can be used, which mother shares. Stabilizing or anchoring myself or identifying myself as this knowing. So when I sit for meditation, if it's beautiful if we sit, because I think it really anchors and roots one. It's different when we say that I am meditative throughout the day, but its quality is different when we actually spend alone time just sitting and observing what's going on in ourselves. So when I sit back in my silences and I stay as the knowing of either thoughts, feelings, sense perceptions, stationing myself as the knowing. Who am I? I am the knowing. Okay, this thought is coming. Who am I? I am the knowing of the thought. So not paying much attention to the content of thought, but noticing that I am knowing it. And knowingly become that knowing. Although unknowingly we all are that. You know, that's why we say unknowingly we all are Buddhas. But knowingly we have to become that. So there is effort required. So this also creates a kind of a detachment from our own thoughts and feelings. That's what mother is talking here, that it's don't believe that it is an easy thing to observe your thoughts, because most of the times I'm not detached. It's only in detaching that I can see wholly what is the content. So now I am looking, I am knowing the thoughts, feelings come and go. So now I can also look at the quality of them. You know, so it's kind of as if you are kind of tearing things apart. And it's hard. Those of us who have tried their hands at it, it's hard process. It requires a lot of effort. Again and again, we get glued. You will see that if for a moment you are able to do this, again and again, this gluing will happen. You are again here. Then you have to kind of, you know, dissociate. Okay, I am the knowing. And then you again are glued. In few moments. So this is unawareness. In unawareness, I become glued again. I become the thought. I become my story. And then I kind of, you know, put effort to dissociate. So this is also stepping back. To observe the thought, the first moment then is to step back and look at it, to separate yourself from the thoughts so that the movement of consciousness and that of thought may not be confused. So this is what we were doing. So I have now, earlier, consciousness is mixed up with thoughts and feelings like this, like a enmeshed kind of thing. Now I am like, you know, tearing, like pulling it apart. Now consciousness is able to see the content of consciousness. Okay. Now they say, ek kamra hai, kamre ke andar ye saman hai. No, so I am now looking at the saman and also standing back as the space of the room. So this gives us a lot of power actually. Now if we try it, earlier what we do, losing ourselves in the thoughts and feelings, we lose a lot of power. If I'm able to dissociate, then I regain my power back. And that's why Sri Aurobindo and mother say, consciousness is force also, chit shakti. So the moment I am able to know myself as the consciousness, I am very, very energetic. You know, I am full of energy. I'm not draining away my power, giving away my power. So that's the beauty of this. And then, you know, here mother says something really, again, very, very powerful. This one. A purified mind is naturally a mind that does not admit any wrong thought. And we have seen that the complete mastery of thought, which is required to gain this result, that I am able to not allow any wrong thought, is the last achievement. So it takes a long time before the purification truly, you know, kind of becomes effortless. So the wrong or the egoistic or the manipulative thoughts, evil thoughts, will remain. It's not that they will kind of go away in one night after meditation. But now I will have the power not to follow their dictate. So they are kind of, you know, we are spiders in the house. And many a time spiders are there and we don't mind them. So we don't give much priority to them. Like, they can also stay. So like that, the thoughts may come and you see that the thought is there. Agenda hai kuch mere mind mein. Manipulation hai kuch mere mind mein. Insecurity bhi hai, want bhi hai usko follow karne ki. But ab main kar nahi rahi. So you hold yourself back. Instead of following the dictate of that kind of insecurity or anxiety or whatever. And that's, that itself is a great achievement. You know, it's a great baby step that you see the manipulation of the ego, but you don't follow it. Yeah, anything we want to share? Anyone?
I have a question. So the question is a bit technical. I want to understand the place of language in this process of observing thoughts. So for example, if my language is not that sound, I do not know the, I cannot give a name to the thought. I cannot, I don't have the terminology to name the thought. So in that case, will I miss the thought? Will I not be able to clearly distinguish that this is the actual thing that is going on in my mind? Or language has no role to play in this process of purification? I mean, what is the role of naming, name and form, name and terminology, giving it to the thought? What is the role of that? Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I think Sambhav, dekho, language ka to role kafi clear hi lag raha hai na? Because we think in words, hai na? Or we think in images. So if I don't have a thought coming as a word, then I may have a thought coming as an image. You know, we always have visuals. So, and it's the same thing. So either I am thinking in words or I will be thinking in images. You know, or the feeling is there. So the idea here, right, what we are discussing here is to, can I not get lost in the trap of either thought, feeling or image, rather than stay as the knowing of the content. Okay, I am here as the knowing of it. I'm not going to get lost in the content. No, because usually the content is so attractive, usually for us, that immediately we get lost. So immediately, right, we kind of get dragged into the forest of word, language and feeling and kind of imagery. And so the idea is, can I hold myself as long as possible as the knowing of the content, which is there, thought, feeling, sense perceptions, just staying there as the knowing.
Because, you know, why I ask this question is that somewhere in the so I was reading this Vedantic text, Drigdishya Vivek. The explanation went like, there was a thing mentioned in that text that while observing your thoughts, it is not a good practice to label the thoughts, because labeling will make their otherwise false presence the real presence. I mean, thought is just in thin air, but when you label the thought, then you solidify the thought, you make it concrete, and then you start to believe that actually there's a actual affirmative presence of that thought in the head. So that is why I just asked that, what is the role of language, you know?
Yeah,
what is the
role of... Yeah, it's quite relevant what you are sharing, that labeling, we just get kind of involved in the drama again. Yeah.
Yeah.
So right. Better not to label. Yes. You know, it's almost like, imagine that there is a lump of formation that I have. Now, in this lump of formation, I have some material content and I have also space. So one way, just one way of expressing it is, I'm trying to kind of sort out space from the lump. And see what happens. You know, so usually my consciousness or awareness is lost in the thoughts, feelings, and sense perceptions. Now, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to almost enmesh this, you know, kind of a mixture so that I can stand back as consciousness, looking at the content of the consciousness. And this, as I was sharing earlier, this actually gives us a lot of power. You know, only here I can say that, okay, I can follow this thought, but not that one. Otherwise, I cannot really do that, even for a moment, because we are usually swayed by the thoughts and feelings rather than being even having a bit of control over them. So it already is a very big step, even at one moment of time, if I recognize, okay, this is the impulse that is there and I see it, but I don't want to follow it. So it's not that the ego is gone. It's not that the me and my story is gone, but I don't give weightage to it anymore. I don't give priority to it anymore. So that itself is I think it's a very big baby step. Although the journey is so long, but the step is very, and you feel that empowerment within, that you were able to kind of take a stand back. And that's why, again, reiterating that consciousness is coupled with force, chit shakti. So the moment I am able to take my stand as consciousness and not get dragged by the thoughts, feelings, and sensations, immediately I feel a sense of empowerment. So that's the shakti part. That's the divine mother along with consciousness. Sat Chit Anand. So this Chit is coupled with the force, the Shakti. That's why I feel empowered. And vice versa, whenever I'm feeling less empowered and whenever I'm feeling really drained and weaker, definitely I've given my power away to some thought, some feeling, some past, you know, kind of theory in my mind or agenda, some opinion, waiting for someone's approval. And that drains my energy. So any further reflections on this, or shall we go ahead?
No, in the same text, Drigdrishya Vivek, I was reading that there are 6 meditation techniques that are given. So 3 of them are internal to you, 3 of them are external to you. So like internal meditation would be how you can observe your thoughts, how an emotion goes in you and you just simply observe it going. Similarly, we can follow the external meditation also. For example, you pick up an object that is that does not have any positive or negative attribute to it. For example, a clock maybe, in which the needles are moving. So you can observe those objects in a very neutral manner, so that it will be the same. It will bring upon the same effect in you as observing your thoughts. So you can watch a bird flying, a tree, or blade of grass flowing in the wind. So you can, if you observe those things, then it will have the same effect as observing the thoughts in you.
Yeah, very interesting. Yes.
But I have a question that does this mean that observing the thought is something like being mindful? Because a lot of mindfulness techniques are also similar to this. that you have to be just, you know, just be, keep yourself away from what things are happening, and you know, you move out of that and see. So observe one thing at a time. So does that mean that it's the same what we are talking presently, or it is something different?
I think if Nehal, you want to say that observing the mind, does it mean that I am being aware of the contents of my being? Then yes.
No,
I don't know what you mean by mindfulness. Yeah.
There are a lot of meditative techniques wherein they ask you to, they teach you that you live in one moment at a time, one moment at a time. So instead of thinking a lot of things of the future or kal kya hoga, fir iske baad kya hoga, aap aaj mein jeena seekho. To wo kaise seekhenge? To aap ek ek moment ko pakad ke usme meditation, mane uska meditation hota hai. So abhi, that is what is mindfulness about, that you need to remain at one point, with all your full concentration, awareness, everything. So does that mean that I am observing myself the way this is described, that we are observing our thought and all? Because this also requires to keep yourself away from the thought, step out of it and observe and be in the very moment. So is it something similar to that?
Actually, although I understand what you're sharing, Nehal, and it can be a beautiful way to be fully present wherever you are. But having said that, it does not, see, first of all, we can never be in two moments. I am always in the present moment. Now, if I ask Nehal, go to a future moment, you can't go. Because even when you go to a future moment, you are doing that in the present moment. So you are glued. You are glued to the present moment. Although I understand what you are sharing, that the mind keeps on going here and there. So
exactly.
To fully be doing whatever you are doing. But at the same time, it does not mean that I cannot think or plan certain events in future, because that's needed. You know, we do plan. No, but what we are talking of here is most of the mental chatter is not a very constructive chatter.
Yeah.
So imagine that you have to organize a meditation session for your, you know, the company that you work for.
Yeah.
You will plan. No, the planning will be required. So that you cannot say, no, I cannot go in future because I have to be here. You can't say that, because that's needed. No, and that's the purpose of us being here. But this mental chatter, what we are talking of here is whenever we are too concerned about me, my story, my approval, my image, my name, my fame, you know, so this me and my story, this obsessive pattern of thinking, this is what is the trouble.
Okay, I got you.
Yeah. Anyone else, anything to share or reflect upon at this moment? Okay, so I'm assuming there is nothing more. So let's take this one more if we have time. This is also very nice. I found it very interesting and very relevant for each one of us. So I'll just read the verse, and maybe one of us can read words by the mother. He has insulted me. He has beaten me. He has humiliated me. He has robbed me. I think all of us can resonate at some or the other level with this, because that's what goes on in our heads mostly. He has insulted me, he has beaten me, he has humiliated me, he has robbed me. Those who nourish thoughts such as these never appease their hatred. So let us, anyone who feels ready to read, if we can read the words by the mother, and then we can reflect upon it. Yeah, anyone?
Yeah, so I'll read it. He has insulted me, he has beaten me, he has humiliated me, he has robbed me. Those who nourish thoughts such as these never appease their hatred. The Dhammapada tells us first of all that bad thoughts bring about suffering and good thoughts bring about happiness. Now, it gives examples of what bad thoughts are and tells us how to avoid suffering. Here is the first example. I repeat, he has insulted me, he has beaten me, he has humiliated me, he has robbed me. And it adds, those who nourish thoughts such as these never appease their hatred. We have begun our mental discipline basing ourselves on the successive stages of mental development, and we have seen that this discipline consists of four consecutive movements, which we have described in this way, as you surely remember: to observe, to watch over, to control, and to master. And in the course of the last lesson, we have learned, I hope, to separate ourselves from our thoughts so as to be able to observe them as an attentive spectator. Today, we have to learn how to watch over these thoughts. First, you look at them and then you watch over them. Learn to look at them as an enlightened judge so that you may distinguish between the good and the bad, between the thoughts that are useful and those that are harmful, between constructive thoughts that lead to victory and defeatist thoughts which turn us away from it. It is this power of discernment that we must acquire now that will be the subject of our meditation tonight. As I have told you, the Dhammapada will give us examples, but examples are only examples. We must ourselves learn how to distinguish thoughts that are good from those that are not, and for that, you must observe, as I have said, like an enlightened judge. This is to say, and as impartially as possible, it is one of the most indispensable conditions. So beautiful.
Cool. Yeah. Thank you. So, you know, again, so beautiful, so clear. Now, Mother has told us, earlier we were talking of what is the difference between observing and watching. And we were talking that there is a bit of discernment and watching, and that's what Mother shares here, that look at them as an enlightened judge. So although they're all so-called mine, although there is no mine in thoughts, they keep on coming and going to each one of us, and yet now I'm able to see the quality of each thought. So imagine what is the power of watching. I'm seeing that, oh my god, you know, look at this, I am so much negative about myself, you know. Oh my God, I am so unfit for this path. I can't do it. So the moment I am able to watch this happening, knowing also the quality of the thought, what I can do is that, for example, again, using words of Mother only, Mother shares that if you see a negative trail going on, turn it into something enlightening. For example, Mother is with me. I will be able to walk on this path. So it's changing the pattern of our kind of thoughts. You know, we all have thought patterns. You know, each one has a very unique thought pattern, although there is similarity, but still there is uniqueness in our patterns. So can I recognize a pattern, especially a defeatist pattern, and then turn it into something which is empowering in nature? That Mother is with me, Sri Aurobindo is with me, the divine is with me, higher intelligence is with me, and I will be able to walk on this path immediately as soon as the negative thoughts come. And how would I know that the thought is a negative one? By the watching of it. The second step, as Mother was sharing. First is an impassive observation where I don't really see the quality of it. But in watching, I'm actually discerning, you know, which is the bad one, which can be kept, which is not needed now, and which is creating more suffering and misery for me. So this is very powerful, actually, you know, that as an enlightened judge, I can distinguish between good and bad, and between thoughts that are useful and those that are harmful. Now, thoughts of jealousy, ill will, anger, hate, being victimized, blaming others, all of these, we know that they are not really very pleasant ones to keep. So can I now, whenever they come, can I transform them now that I am able to watch over them? Can I transform it? Yeah. This is the power of discernment. Yeah. This is the subject of our meditation. So again, it can be actually used as a tool for those of us wanted that if I sit for meditation for some time and I look at these patterns coming, can I immediately hand it over to the divine that, mother, look at this pattern again. I offered this to you. So either offering or transforming, whatever works for anyone. And this is almost like a cleaning happening, you know, in our being. Continuous cleaning is required. Just like we clean and dust our houses all the time. You know, internal mamla bhi bilkul same hai, you know. Continuous cleaning is required. The moment I falter, again, the garbage gets collected. We don't even realize that the garbage, gets collected. And it's only when I'm feeling again very low, dipped in energy, and then I can, you know, be aware that, oh my God, what did I collect really in the moments of unawareness?
So this bad thoughts and good thoughts can be relative to one person to the other, because something good for you might not be good thought for me. Is it so?
आप एग्जाम्पल दो जो आपके लिए अच्छा होगा और मेरे लिए नहीं होगा.
लाइक मे बी नो फॉर एग्जाम्पल सपोज टू मच ऑफ एंथुजियाज्म मे बी आई एम कॉस्टिंग इट एट समवेयर एंड मे बी दैट इज क्रिएटिंग प्रॉब्लम इन माय वर्किंग और आई डोंट नो हाउ टू पुट इट लाइक
ओके आई थिंक
थॉट बट
या आई थिंक आई एम try to, you know, see if I'm getting it and I'll try to put it in words. So imagine that I am a very kind of a mellow person and dull, not really mellow. I am dull and a bit of enthusiasm may be good for me, right? So I say to myself that yes, I will be able to do it and let us do it. So I am dull and this enthusiastic thought is kind of pulling me up. Now, for a person who is already very, very enthusiastic, he actually has to calm himself down that, hey, relax. So maybe this is what you were sharing. I don't know. I'm just.
Yeah, something similar like this.
Yeah.
Like somebody is like too sensitive or maybe too emotional about everything. And there might be somebody who is really insensitive towards certain things. And maybe they need to really work on that part. So then being sensitive can be harmful. Like वो होता है ना कि ज़्यादा empathetic हो गए, बहुत ज़्यादा empathetic या बहुत ज़्यादा over sensitive होना भी नुकसान करता है. तो there is one complete section of theory जिसमें ऐसे चलता है कि जो लोग over empathetic लोग होते हैं, उनका nature अलग ही किस्म का होता है. So over empathy can also be harmful to somebody. तो maybe अगर मेरे लिए over empathized मैं हो गई हूँ, so can it be considered a thought which I need to control?
No, I think mother here shares that if you think that it's harming you, so it's, we are the only judge, you know, I cannot enter your mind, you cannot enter my mind, right?
Exactly. So it can be like that, no, that the definition of a bad thought for me is different than the definition of bad thought for somebody else.
Not all the time, because if you are jealous, jealousy cannot be good for me either. So I would say not all the time, but I'm sure there would be uniqueness also that maybe you need to pep up yourself and I need to calm down myself. So I'm sure there would be differences. Yeah. And only I would know, you know, jo mere ko peaceful kar raha hai, jo mere ko shant kar raha hai, saaf kar raha hai, only I would know. And jo aapko help kar raha hai, only you would know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, anyone else? Poison is poison, right? So poison cannot be good for anyone. And most of the thoughts that we harbor are poisonous. We know that. Yeah. Yes, Sambhav, you wanted to share?
Yeah. So I, this one more thing, in addition to observing the thoughts, there's something called focusing or ekagrata, jise kehte hai. तो मेरा क्वेश्चन ये है कि व्हाट इज अ बेसिक डिफरेंस बिटवीन फोकसिंग योर माइंड ऑन वन ऑब्जेक्ट एंड लेटिंग द थॉट्स पास इन यू एंड व्हाट इज द इंटरप्ले बिटवीन दीज टू थिंग्स दैट वी कीप ऑन डूइंग इन आवर लाइव्स व्हाट इज द रोल ऑफ फोकसिंग एंड व्हाट इज द रोल ऑफ मेडिटेशन. थैंक यू.
So anyone, any comments on any reflections on what Sambhav has just shared? Yeah, yeah.
So I think what I understand is that when we meditate, during the process of meditation, this focusing and concentration comes as a byproduct. So focusing is not meditating. This is what I understand. Meditation is something more than focusing, and focusing usually is generally done, or it comes in the way of process, in the process of meditation. It's just a small part. Now how we take it is up to us, because there are different meditative techniques wherein also you do lot of focusing and concentration, but then that's not the purpose of meditation. This is what I understand.
But what I want to ask is that can both focusing and meditation go hand in hand? As in, can these two be integrated into one process so that there's no need for, this bifurcation between these two, the two things?
Have you tried it, Sambhav?
I do try it. I focus a lot. I mean, I just sit in a Sukhasana posture and look at the clock in front of me and just try to not move my gaze from that clock, and I try to keep at it. But that is also it's in a way meditative in nature, because then the thoughts are blocked, the unwanted thoughts are blocked. But again, I feel that meditation is something more, just like ma'am said, there's a whole new dimension to meditation, which is not focusing. It is beyond that. But my basic inquiry is that can these two be merged into one thing so that you do not have this, you have kind of a non-dualist thing going on, like you don't distinguish between the two.
So when you say, obviously, as you are sharing, Snehal has shared, and I think all of us experience also, that meditation is different from concentration. So definitely there is a difference. Purpose also may be different. But the ultimate purpose is only one. If I'm using a ladder or a lift, where do I want to go? To the chhat.
Hmm.
So either ladder helps or the lift helps. Or mm-hmm. I climb up like a monkey.
Mm-hmm.
Have I reached the terrace or not? I think that's what we are concerned with. So if you want to conjoin meditation and concentration, which I'm sure is absolutely possible, why not? Why not? Because the ultimate goal is the realization of my own being, and that continues. It's a never-ending process. So whether meditation is helping, whether any other tool is helping, or concentration plus meditation is helping, am I moving towards the goal? I think that's the focus.
Right, right.
Yeah. Yes, Shweta.
Yeah, so actually, rightfully, both are like so interconnected, and they ultimately lead to something that is beyond both. So even I feel like, when you think of children and how we talk about sharpening their senses, so we come from larger to the, from collective to individual, and I think the purpose of coming to individual is to get a hold on ourselves, or to understand better, connect to ourselves. And then once we connect to ourselves, we understand how we are part of, there is no separation. So I think it goes like that only, from outer to inner. And once we realize the inner, we realize that the purpose itself to connect and meditate and focus is like, just today I was listening to Rupert Spira. He was telling the same thing, how, the infinite expresses as a local self. And it's like, there is a scenery, and if we observe with a macro lens, you know, like we just zoom and we just focus on one single thing. As soon as you focus on one single thing, the everything else will be blurred out, you know. But you know, like, you know, once you get it, then you understand ki it's just part of, you know, the whole. So it's just for you to understand it and then to merge with the higher self, you know, the infinite self.
Yeah, yes. Mother has actually shared many things about meditation also and what it does. And basically, it works on our being aware of being aware. So I am now aware. Earlier, I was aware in my unawareness, but now I am aware of my awareness. And the purpose of concentration, Mother again shares, those who want, you know, they can go incarnate word pe aap search kar sakte ho, concentration and meditation. Or concentration, why concentration is needed? Because usually our mind is a dispersed mind. You know, main ek minute idhar sochti hu, fir udhar sochti hu, fir kisi aur ki yaad aa jati, you know, so it's a very scattered mind. And people who are artistically oriented or who are learning a skill or something, what they then tend to do is they have to put effort to concentrate. So putting effort to concentrate, because the mind is usually lazy, it does not want to concentrate, that is what we call as tapas. You know, you are doing a tapasya, we are concentrated our energies on one single object. I think that is again like intensifying the power of mind, usually, which is so scattered here and there. And both have their advantages. And I'm sure, as Sambha was suggesting, we actually, all of us, do alternate between meditating and concentrating, because both of them help on this path. So concentration is basically you are pinpointing your energies on one focus. Yes, Shweta.
No, what came to my mind was like, it's just collective to individual to oneness. So it moves like that.
Yeah, beautiful. Yes. And concentration also acts like a digger. No, and it tears apart the veil. You know, for example, appearances deceive. So an object like a glass or something, if I concentrate on just even closing my eyes, if I concentrate on the appearance of the glass, at one point it will happen that I pierce through the appearance and go beyond the appearance of the glass. As Shweta was sharing, going first of all from collective to individualizing, and then individualized to a basic oneness in our nature, the oneness that we share. So that is again kind of hinting at what concentration, and I'm sure there is more to it. Yeah. Anything more? Anyone? Okay. So I'm assuming there is nothing more. So thank you everyone for joining in at a very short kind of notice. I just had an idea that maybe I had time, and I thought if people are interested, we could do this. So I'll share this PDF with all of you who have joined today. With some I've already shared. And whenever you are at home, at leisure, you can go through Mother's words and reflect and maybe contemplate over them. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.